surely be me. Thought I could be what I wanted to be. I thought I could build on life's sinking sand, but I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountain's too high and the valley's too wide.
Thank you, Teri. On behalf of Gene Snyder's family, I want to thank you for being here. Don't even have to say a thing. Just being present means so much to the family. We're here for three very good reasons. The first, of course, is to give respect and our love to a relationship that was important to each of us. I did not know him like you knew him. But after a visit last Wednesday with the family, I just knew this is a man that I wish I could have known well. And you had that relationship, and I know that you will cherish those memories. We're also here to give expressions of our love to the family, those who will miss him the most. So on behalf of the family, thank you for all of those ways you respond to his death by giving love and words of encouragement to them. The third reason we're here is because when news comes that someone that we have loved has been taken from us, we realize someday we too will make the crossing from this life to the life that God has promised us. And so we face in our own life our mortality. And the last time I checked, the mortality rate is 100%. So to help us with those thoughts, I don't think about death very often until news comes that a dear one has been taken from us. To help us with that, I want to read to you perhaps the most familiar psalm, sometimes referred to as the Shepherd's Psalm. I'm convinced that when David wrote this psalm, he was outdoors. I did not say on a golf course, but he was outdoors. The Lord is my shepherd. I have everything I need. He lets me rest in green meadows. He leads me beside peaceful streams. He renews my strength. He guides me along right paths, bringing honor to his name. Even when I walk through the dark valley of death, I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me. Your rod and your staff protect and comfort me. You prepare a feast for me in the presence of my enemies. You welcome me as a guest, anointing my head with oil. My cup overflows with blessings. Surely your goodness and unfailing love will pursue me all the days of my life, and I will live in the house of the Lord forever. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us a time and place to remember and to celebrate the life of Gene Snyder. Lord, we have received him into our lives and into our relationships as a gift from you. So we're meeting today to say thank you, Lord, for giving us a good man who loved life and loved those that he had opportunity to have relationship with. Lord, I pray for Wanda. I pray for the family today. I pray for those who maybe, perhaps, are just now getting the news that Gene is no longer with us. I pray, Heavenly Father, that you would give each of us renewed faith today, that you would renew the hope that we have that this life is not all there is, and our faith will take a new step forward today. Thank you for giving us of your presence and your love that surrounds each of us, and especially this special family. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. It's my honor to read the obituary of Gene Snyder. Gene Snyder, a lifelong resident of the Wenatchee Valley, passed away at his home the morning of April 11, 2011. He was born in Wenatchee on July 27, 1924, to Bert and Ethel Snyder. Growing up in Wenatchee as the youngest of six kids, Gene enjoyed an active and fun childhood. He graduated from Wenatchee High School on January 14, 1943, and entered the service soon thereafter. After a successful stint in the Army serving under Lieutenant General Mark Clark during World War II in the Italian Theater, Gene returned to Washington State to attend Washington State University. Go Cougs. Gene began working at C&O Nursery at a very young age, and by the time he entered college, he already knew the Latin names for numerous plant varieties, giving him a leg up on many in his class. Gene loved to bowl, dance, and golf, and he became proficient at each. He was asked to tap dance with Sammy Davis Jr. during his early 20s and enjoyed anything that benefited from rhythm. Gene loved youngsters and for 20-plus years was the annual Santa Claus at the Wenatchee Elks Club, of which he was a lifetime member. Starting much later in life than most, Gene took up golf at the age of 35 and joined the Wenatchee Golf and Country Club in 1964, retaining his membership for the past 47 years. With the remarkable accomplishment of 4 holes-in-1, 2 on number 14, 2 on number 17, he often shunned the limelight and would boast more about how his son got a hole-in-1 on the same length hole, 1 year and 1 week to the day of his first accomplishment. Gene met Wanda Richardson on her 18th birthday, but delayed a steady courtship due to Wanda's young age. They were married November 5, 1960, and loved each other for 50 1/2 years. Gene shone as a registered landscape architect, and after spending a month in Japan studying under Mr. Tomen Sano in 1968, came back to an award-winning landscape design career for C&O. Some of his many awards include the E.P. Marcus Home in 1968, the Harvey Davis Home in 1969, the Cascade Natural Gas Building in 1970, as well as the Omak Funeral Home. He was co-owner of C&O Nursery with his brothers John and Bob. He retired in September of 1989 to golf, travel, and spend time with his family, which he enjoyed up until the very recent past. He's survived by his wife Wanda, his children, Todd and Beth, his 3 brothers, John Snyder and Bob Snyder, both of Wenatchee, and Al Snyder of Dayton, Washington, his sister Margaret Sampson of Wenatchee, and 6 grandchildren, Todd Jr., TJ, Ty Snyder, Tia Snyder, Katie Wagg, Stephanie O'Brien, and Samantha O'Brien. He was preceded in death by his parents, Bert Snyder in 1962, and Ethel Snyder in 1984, and his sister, Florence Dalwick of Youngstown, Ohio, in 1995. While he will be greatly missed by his large family and many friends, we find solace in the fact that he is absent from the body and present with the Lord. In addition to reading the obituary, Gene's family asked that I share some of their comments, their memories regarding Gene, and I'd like to start with those comments provided by Wanda. And this is entitled, How We Met. Wanda worked for Dr. Bunker. On her 18th birthday, he suggested that we go to the Elks for dinner. When we got there, Doctor saw Gene, who was his neighbor, and invited him over to the table to have dinner with us and spend the evening visiting and dancing. When the evening was over, Doctor said, I'm ready to take you home now. But Gene asked if he could take me home. Since Doctor knew him as a personal friend, he said okay, even though Gene was 30. On the way home, Gene said he was glad to meet me, and he was heading out to Sun Valley for a 3-day ski trip, and that he would call me when he got back. 3 years later, he finally called. And that was due to his date canceling on him on New Year's Eve. And his sister telling him, why don't you call that cute nurse from Dr. Bunker's office? When he finally called me at work, I immediately put the phone down and went to doctor's office and said, Gene Snyder's on the phone, and he wants to take me out. And the doctor said, well, go. And I replied, no, he waited 3 years to call me. He can wait a little longer. Gene made Wanda wait 3 years, and Wanda made Gene wait 1 week. On January 6, 1960, we began seeing each other. We were engaged on the 24th, on my 24th birthday, April 12th, and upon planning our wedding, I told him I wanted to be a June bride. Nope, I'm putting in lawns in June. How about the spring? Nope, I'm too busy landscaping. Well, what are you doing in November? Well, I think I could work that in. We were happily married on November 5, 1960. Gene's son, Todd, shares the following. Dad was so upbeat, he constantly would say, whatever was the most recent and best anything. The best clam chowder, the best pizza, the best dancing Tia had done, the best vacation, the best place we've ever gone. We would all just agree, smile, and chuckle to ourselves. I remember as a very young boy going to the Father's Day golf tournament, and back in those days, the parking lot was very uneven. We got there early to join in the breakfast with the other fathers and sons, and I opened the door and stepped out, but the level of the parking lot was much different at this spot, so I stumbled out of the car, falling and cutting open my calf. Dad calmly talked with me and said we were going to the doctor. We not only got to the doctor, but we were able to get in. This was a long time ago. I got some stitches and an ace bandage and the assurance from all that if I wanted to play, I could. So without telling Mom, we headed back to the course, straight to our hole to start. No breakfast and don't remember the details of the round, but I totally remember Dad's smile that we were able to play because it meant so much to the both of us. Yes. Now after we got home and had to spill the beans to Mom, that begins an entirely different story. I remember how truly happy he was to see family, how thankful we all were for God letting him have some rally moments in his struggles so he could partake in things such as being able to spend their 50th anniversary celebration on a wonderful cruise this last August and seeing his oldest grandson get married. I remember helping him circumnavigate the streets of Nassau, Bahamas one morning off of the ship so that we could look for medicine he needed, only to spend an hour getting to the pharmacy to hear, oh, you need a doctor's prescription for that. So we turned around and headed back to the ship, laughing, saying to one another, I don't remember this tour being on the brochure. I remember sitting with him a few short weeks ago when he said, let's watch your senior recital. So in the DVD goes, and for 70 minutes we were both so young, and I'm thinking to myself, this is the last time he's going to see me play, only to have God grant him the strength and our big band scheduled to be playing just down the street at the country club. So on March 19th, the family got him down there for what I thought would be 30 minutes. He stayed the entire 2 hours, and sure enough, after we finished, that was the best I ever heard you play. I'm thinking he was on too much medication. The life's lessons I learned from my father. Show friends, family, and strangers that you are enjoying them. Truly listen, keep a smile, laugh, tell them your feelings. Love is best demonstrated by your own actions and expressions. Yes. It brightens everyone's day. Todd's dad loved to hear him play. Todd would like to play a short selection at this time.
Thank you.
the rhythm passes from generation to generation. Gene's daughter Beth shares the following. On Christmas Eve, when Todd and I were little, Dad would always take us on a family drive to look at all the Christmas lights. When we were on vacation at Universal Studios, someone came up to Dad asking him for his autograph because he thought my dad was Jonathan Winters. Dad had a hard time convincing him that he wasn't. My dad got the biggest kick out of that, and we had a good laugh afterwards. We continued to call him Jonathan Winters. Dad's family meant the world to him, and because of the love and his great family values he gave to us, I now share that same family love with my family. Grandson TJ shares the following. I'll always remember the happiness encased in his smile, no matter if he was having a great day or a not so great day. His smile always exuded happiness and love. He was always glad to see you, even if he had just done so the previous day. His optimistic nature and wry sense of humor were always accompanied by a hearty laugh and smile. I'll miss his jokes. Hopefully, I remember most of them to tell my children and grandchildren. Many golf tournaments during the summers of my teen years were captained by him. Most of my golfing accomplishments were done with him close. I was playing with him when I first broke 100 on my 12th birthday. A year later, when I first broke 90, when I first beat my father, July 4, 1997, I shot 79, Dad shot an 83. When I was 17 and had my first and only hole-in-one at Desert Air Golf Course, the first and only ever hit on the short 274-yard par 4 seventh hole, but who's bragging? And when my dad and I won the Wenatchee Golf and Country Club father-son tourney in 2003. Those memories I'll always remember, the sense of pride and enjoyment he showed during all of them. A lot of people have asked me over the years why I wear a rubber band around my wrist. Usually they assume because I'm a practical-minded engineer. However, the real reason is much closer to my heart. In August of 2001, when I was 17, Grandpa and I had driven to Idaho to play in my last PNGA Junior Amateur Tournament. I played excellently during the first 36 holes, 2 days, a combined 2 over par and 8th out of 144 golfers. The highlight was sinking a 30-foot birdie putt on the final hole as Grandpa clapped, cheered, and looked on. After that, the tournament switched to match play from stroke play. The next day, I was resoundingly beaten by an opponent that I felt I had no business beating me. That night, we drove back to Wenatchee, and of course, being 17, I was concerned about reliving my round and figuring out just where I went wrong and other trivial matters. During the trip back, he turned to me with a seriousness somewhat unusual for him, and he said to me, "No matter what happens, TJ, you have to snap back. You have to snap back like a rubber band, and I'm not just talking about golf." I didn't fully appreciate that life lesson until some years later, but I now choose to wear a rubber band around my wrist because that statement is about the best life truism I can think of, and what better way to remember it. Thanks for helping me realize what life is about, Grandpa. I'll always snap back. TJ shares this funny story. At the end of July 1997, Grandpa and I flew to San Diego for me to compete in the Junior World Golf Tournament. The trip down was uneventful, and we drove to the hotel we were staying at and checked in. Opening the door to our room, we were both taken aback as the only things we could see were a single bed and a closet. No bathroom or any kind of food prep area. Grandpa was not amused and reacted with some grumbling and decidedly unchristian words. He trudged back down the steps to have a chat with the manager. And at that point, I closed the door slightly. In opening up the door completely, Grandpa had hidden the entrance to the main room, which contained the rest of the amenities. Running out to the balcony, I hoped to catch Grandpa before he got to the office, but to no avail. I saw him walking into the office. A minute or so later, he came back up to our room, red-faced and laughing about his mistake. Then he poured himself a tall rum and coke. his drink of choice on our golfing trips. Katie, one of Gene's grandchildren, shares the following. When I would go over to visit Grandpa, I would go and sit on his lap, and he would sing me my special Katie song. Katie, beautiful Katie, you're the one that I adore. I'll always remember the golf cart rides. Grandpa laughed a lot, and so I laugh a lot. Gene's grandson, Ty, would like to share one of his own memories personally.
Probably one of my favorite memories of my grandpa was about when I was about 5 years old. Yeah, he wanted to go fishing. He went down to the Wenatchee River and he just took me along. And I just killed some time. I just had fun with him while he was down there. After a while, he hadn't really caught anything. So he pulls out a peach, starts peeling it. And he says, I got you this knife. It's a little small red Swiss Army knife that he had gotten for me. And he says, this peach is perfect. It's something that somebody had to work very hard for. And no matter what you have to do in life, you're always going to be having to work hard if you want to get anywhere. So that's something that really stuck with me as something when I was younger with him, impressed upon me. And probably the most important lesson that he actually taught me, it sounds like a lot of my family agrees, was how to love. He knew that you touch the people that are in your life, and it's what you do, your actions, that will do it. It's not anything you can say necessarily. So I've been trying to help him out as much as I can. I never feel like I finished the list, that there's always so many things that need to be done for them because they've given me so much. It seems like no matter what was going on, my grandpa always had a joke. He was always lighthearted, and he never let his situation hold him back. He lived like he was the happiest man on earth, and it wouldn't surprise me if he was. I'll always love you for everything, Grandpa.
Thank you, Ty. Granddaughter Stephanie shares the following memory, an interesting one at that. I remember my grandpa chasing me around the house with a fly swatter to spank me. Okay. How about that? Granddaughter Tia provides the following. I don't remember a time in my life when my grandfather wasn't involved each day, cheering me on in whatever I attempted, supporting me in my dreams and aspirations, and always encouraging and believing in me. Golf plays a large part in the life of the Snyder family, and many of my memories are accompanied by the smell of cut grass and the warmth of the sun. But the warmth of my grandfather's love as he drove with me in his golf cart, bragging on my shots and encouraging me to do better, is the strongest memory of all. While we don't suffer from true sibling rivalry, I do need to point out that Grandpa said, more than once, and there are witnesses, Tia has so much more talent than TJ or Ty. But she's the one that likes golfing the least. For the rest of my life, when I head to the course, I will take my grandfather with me in my heart and in my memories. My grandfather taught me a great deal, but perhaps more than anything else, he taught me the importance of family. His lessons were passed down to my father and mother, and I have learned the same from them. Finally, Samantha shares, one time when I was giving Grandpa a hug, I told him he was fat. Stephanie and Katie looked at each other with an oh my gosh look, and Grandpa laughed and said, I sure am. And a few years ago, Katie and Stephanie and Samantha sent a Father's Day card to Gene, and it said, "Your love and kindness and the way you've treated us through the years have given us a lifetime of reasons to be thankful. I'm so glad you're our grandpa." I'd like to thank the Snyders for allowing me to read these memories. And if I may just share one thought as I depart the stage, I'm really blessed in a couple of ways. One way, I'm an old man with young kids, and I understand that old is a relative term, Floyd. But I'm an old man with young kids, and that's a great blessing. The other blessing I have in my life is I have a best friend, and that's Todd Snyder. And I see Gene in Todd every day. I'm very thankful for that. Thank you.
Keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk. Let me walk close to Thee, just a closer walk with Thee. Daily walking close to Thee, let it be, O Lord, let it be. When my feeble life is o'er, time for me is my plea. Oh, daily walking close to Thee, let it be, dear Lord, let it be.
I can only imagine.
God bless you guys. Thank you so much.
I know you're glad you came today. Have you ever been to a celebration of life and heard a drum solo? Gene's favorite son. Yeah. And thank you, family, for those words of tribute. All of us today have the opportunity to let our faith grow. I am only 70 years old, but looking back over my brief life, I realize my faith has grown best in the challenges of life. When everything's on cruise and everything's just going great, it's great. But when faith gets tested, it has a chance to grow. Life is filled with changes. Gene was born right here in Wenatchee. He was an infant for a while, and then he became a child. A child doesn't stay a child. Well, some of us try to. We become teenagers. And how many of us are thankful that teenage life is terminal? They will grow out of it. Young adult does not stay young adult. Adult does not stay adult. Life is filled with changes. And in every change of life, faith grows. I'm so glad that we are in a week where we are celebrating that death is not the end. Can I hear an amen? Easter Sunday, just a few days away. And today we've gathered because of a significant loss. However, it's springtime, and we are reminded that life follows what seems to be dead. People in the nursery business understand that. Huh? I am so thankful that we have a God who never leaves us alone, never leaves us in the dark, never leaves us when everything seems lifeless. I grew up in Nebraska. Springtime only lasts about 3 weeks. Winters are long and summers are long. During my first year in college, my parents moved to the Dalles. I came at Christmas time to visit them, and I saw these ugly cherry orchards. Those trees are not pretty. I wondered why they are letting them occupy the land. Just wait till springtime. Oh, now I understand why they are so crooked and they're not beautiful. They're planted for the fruit that is produced. This is God's way. This is God's way to help us know that death is only a shadow, only a threshold we step across. Last Monday morning, when Gene took his last breath here, he took his first breath with the Lord. Gene lived with the assurance that death is not the end. He had the assurance in his heart, testified in many ways to his family. I'll only tell you two stories. Two stories that have inspired me, Ted and Beth, since last Wednesday, and Wanda. Corey, is Corey here? Corey said he was going to come today. Where's Corey? Where's Corey? There he is. Corey was with Jean as a caregiver. And this is the story, Corey, that I was told about you. And it sounds just like you, so I'm glad you're here to hear it from me. Corey was holding Jean's hand, and they were talking about golf. And with Gene's assurance that heaven was his home, Corey said, well, Gene, when I get to heaven, how am I going to find you? On the golf course? And he said, yes. Where will I find you? And he said, 14. I also heard the story about Todd and Ty, who were with him, and he was kind of letting them know he'd like to set up, and so they got on either side of him, put their arms behind him to lift him up, and Todd said they kind of lifted him quicker than he thought he would come to an upright position. And so he put his hands down and tried to steady himself there on the bed and was kind of disoriented just for a small bit. And then when he came, kind of realized he was okay, he says, darn it, I'm not there yet. We live with that assurance. You know, there are some people who are afraid of death. King Louis in France was one of those. So he ordered no one could ever say the word death in his presence. Guess what? He died. I want to read to you from Revelation chapter 21 about this heaven that Gene held in his heart. John the Apostle writes, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the old heaven and the old earth had disappeared. And the sea was also gone. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven like a beautiful bride prepared for her husband. I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, 'Look, the home of God is now among his people. He will live with them and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. He will remove all their sorrows and there will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain, for the old world and its evils are gone forever.' And the one sitting on the throne said, 'Look, I'm making all things new.' And then he said to me, 'Write this down, for what I tell you is trustworthy and true.' And he also said, 'It is finished. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To all who are thirsty, I will give the springs of the water of life without charge. All who are victorious will inherit all these blessings, and I will be their God, and they will be my children.'" I found the story about a man who was near death, and he just enjoyed telling stories about his experiences in World War II. And the grandkids especially just enjoyed his stories. So when he kind of had told several, one of the grandchildren said, "Grandpa, tell us the best victory you were ever part of." And he said, "Well, the best victory is going to happen about 5 minutes after I die." That's the victory that we have promised here in this last book in our Bible. The victory that is for those who have placed their faith in Jesus the Christ, the one who has prepared the place for us, and he calls us to himself. The God of the Bible is with us today. He is holding the family. He is holding on to those who will miss Gene the most. He is the faithful one. And so we are going to join our voices in singing a hymn that has been requested by the family. Great is thy faithfulness, and we celebrate that as we celebrate the life of Gene Snyder. Let's stand together as we sing.
Why don't we take our hymnals so that you have words in front of you? I don't see any words up there, so grab your hymnal, it ought to be in front of you, and turn to hymn number 43. Gordon, give us another run on that.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. Summer and winter and springtime. faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Remain standing. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for your sweet spirit here. Thank you for this precious family. Thank you, Lord, for all the cherished memories. At the same time, we say goodbye to Jean, Lord. We hold on to those memories and that love that was in our hearts in whatever our relationship has been with him, that love can be multiplied. Help us, Lord, to take those qualities that were so noble and so worthy in Jean Snyder and bring those into our own life as a living memorial. I pray this in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. You may be seated, and the family will be dismissed. We're all invited to a reception. The address for that is in East Wenatchee. It's in the program, but the family will be dismissed now, and they are anxious to receive your words of comfort and hope and encouragement. Thank you again for coming.
I pour my heart out to a listening ear. But I see this life, its valleys and mountains, and I think of all the roads that brought me here. Oh, that brought me here. Walking down the road. Well, I've questioned my reasons, this life I'm living. I questioned my ability to judge wrong from right. Well, I questioned all the things I've ever called certain. My race, my religion, my country, my mind. But the one thing I don't question is you. You really love me like you say you do. You really love me like you say you do. So hold. Questions, significance, meaning, and relevance. Does the work I'm doing really matter at all? Will I question my friendships alive?